Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana. Louisiana, Louisiana, Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana All American Sports Show. Louisiana. Louisiana, Louisiana. If it's sports you want to talk about, then listen to the hottest show that's coming out the South.
We tried, but hey, you know, we're in a very tough division, and you know, in District 5A, that's where a lot of great teams we've seen, playoff type teams, Scotland Bills, the Catholic Highs, the Saint Amans, you know, the Dutch Channels, and you know, so it's a very tough division. I have to give Coach Hilton a lot of credit. His first year, we're trying to build something down there. I see a lot of potential in McKinley, but the things that I'm constantly seeing every game is penalties and turnovers. And when you have penalties and turnovers against a team that you're already kind of overmatched against, then you have to, you know, you need every, pretty much have to play perfectly in order to beat a team like that. And last night, coming out in the first series of the game, McKinley came out with two penalties right out the gate, which backed them up 10 yards. And it seems like after that, just could never get in rhythm from that time when they punted the ball. Here comes Saint Amant. Saint Amant did a great job with being able to execute exactly how they wanted in all three phases of the game, not only on the offense, but their defense was stout, and also their special teams. They had a special teams a punt return for a touchdown to take the score to 14-0. As Saint Amant, the first series of the game came out, McKinley gave them a first down on the 4th and 2, and it seems like right after that, that's when it just seemed like once it started, it wasn't stopped. You know, it didn't stop. The score was actually 33-0 at halftime. And so McKinley came, it was able to come out in the second half and do somewhat a little better. They changed up the offense a little bit. They had a couple of plays that they didn't use that I didn't see them use before this year. And I think the diversity on the offense, you have to change it up a little bit. It seemed to me like Saint Amant was zoned in on a lot of those plays, and so I give their coach a lot of credit for video playing, you know, watching video and watching tape of this McKinley high offense. What was your take from the game?
I'll tell you this much, Joker. They were very well coached, and they're going to be facing another very well coached team next week. We have our guest who just called in a moment ago, Coach Benny Saya of the Dutchtown Griffins. He is actually live on the line with us. Coach, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Very much appreciated.
Thank you, Coach.
Hey, man, this is Coach Perry Daniels. I don't know what coach you guys thought I was, but...
Oh, okay.
I should have known by the voice.
Alrighty. Okay.
You couldn't distinguish between the two coaches?
Man, I heard... No. We were expecting Coach Saya. I literally called Coach Saya 2 seconds before Perry called, hung up the phone, thought he was calling back.
Right.
I said, hey.
So it sounds like I better hang up, but... neither one of you have a Skype.
No, I'll open it up, Perry. I thought that was Coach Sam. I'm like, well, why would I Skype? I don't know your Skype. No, sit tight, Perry. We'll get you going. I didn't realize that's who it was. So,
okay, I'll hang up so Coach Sam can join.
Yes, sir. Okay.
All right.
That was interesting. I'm still, so anyway, Joker. Let me reset myself then.
Yeah. That kind of reminds me of, you know, when you watch a movie and you know. Someone comes to the door, and then you know someone you don't like or whatever, and you like, man, and then they actually leave, and
right.
Then your mother comes to the door. You ever see that? And then you go to the door thinking that someone you don't like, so you open the door and say, hey, get out of here.
But right. Hey, that's a classic gag.
Yeah, that's like a classic gag.
Classic.
That's what that reminded me of.
That was that.
We thought it was one coach, and hey, it was actually Coach Perry.
That is funny. Timing is, well, that's fascinating. Anyway, back to my two cents on the game last night.
Game.
So yeah, look, I mean, I knew that Santa Ma was pretty good. That they were going to be confident coming in, and you could tell, like at the beginning of the game, you know, we looked. Santa Ma was already 5-0 coming in. They had really, really hammered a lot of their opponents. So we knew it was not going to be easy. But I'll tell you, they really just dominated from the beginning. They jumped on top of McKinley early. They had the interception in the end zone, which took a lot of the wind out of the Panthers' sails. You had a Santa Monica team that's very well coached, very deep. I thought very well prepared, to your point. It looks like they did a lot of work in the film room, like you said. And I think the end result was that, they dominated from start to finish. Their quarterback looked like a guy who, you know, I spoke with Blake Bourgeois, did it again, Briggs Bourgeois, the kicker and receiver, and he had mentioned that the quarterback spends all kinds of time. So the quarterback will probably be out first thing in the morning throwing balls. He prepares very hard. It just showed, and you saw the difference. And I'm not saying McKinley doesn't prepare well. I'm just saying you're looking at a team that is a program that is developed and up here and has a chance to contend, and then you have a developing team like McKinley, and this is the difference. And you saw it firsthand last night.
Yeah, we saw it firsthand last night, and kudos to their quarterback. That guy, you know, in a strange way, he kind of reminds me of Drew Brees a little bit, because he was short in stature, but he was very accurate. If you saw the passes, it looked like some of the passes could be intercepted, but it was like right over the linebacker's head. I'm talking about post patterns, fade routes, in the corner of the end zone, and he was putting it right on the money.
Right.
Like, man, and he reminded me of Drew Brees, because he spread the ball around to different receivers.
He did. He must have hit about five or six different receivers total last night. I didn't see his final stat line. But I thought he did a great job of having some, I guess, diversity of his targets, for lack of a better word, and just threw the ball with a lot of good zip. I mean, the accuracy downfield, short, medium, and long range for a high school quarterback, I was really, it's not the kind of accuracy you necessarily expect to see out of a kid at that level. But, I mean, look, he delivered and then some. So
yeah, and it's going to be very exciting. You see, Scotlandville pulled it out last night
mm-hmm.
against Zachary, last second touchdown.
That was
I want to congratulate Levi Lewis, man. You know, of course, we've had him here in the studio. He's been our game player of the week a couple of times.
Yep.
with him. But I'm excited to see. We've seen a lot of good teams here this year, so I'm kind of excited to see what's going to transpire in the playoff. I think that Santa Ma is as good a team I've seen this year.
Yeah,
of course, Scotlandville,
very together.
Right, Scotlandville, man. Even Denham Springs, they look good. So, I mean, I'm excited to see what we got going.
No, I am as well, Joker. And I was really like I said, it was that is something for the McKinley Panthers to aspire to in a couple of years. I mean, they are on the right path. They have the right coaching plan. They have the right, coaching mindset, for lack of a better term. And, I really like what Coach Hilton is doing. I like where they're going. It's just they're not there yet, and it's gonna take some patience. You know, Rome was not built in a day. So, I have quite a bit of faith in what Coach Hilton's doing. But there's no doubt about it. The player that really stood out to me was their wide receiver, was Briggs Bourgeois. He's not only a wide receiver, but he's also a kicker and a punter and a kick returner. And he did all of that. He almost scored a two-point conversion, but it came off of the board. So they did all of that. And I got to tell you, that you hear about these kids that do it all, and this kid really did it all. He will be joining us in about 5 minutes right here on the Louisiana All American Sports Show. But what did you think about that fella? And also, who are some of the other players that stood out to you last night?
Well, of course, he stood out to me. I talked about him not only being a very good athlete, very, very fast. He played wide receiver. He was able to break the team down and get into the open spots. He just seemed to overmatch the defense. And a lot of time, he was wide open.
Right.
I was like, why would you let number 23 stay wide open? But
hey, two, three guys on him if you have to. You know?
And then one time at the second half, they did start to double him, but he still was able to get the ball. The second series of the game, he ran a punt return back.
It was 60-yard punt return for a touchdown.
60-yard punt return, and so, and he can kick 50-yard field goals.
Right.
And he's, punt the ball 50 yards.
And he's kicking the ball out of the, we joked about it, he was kicking the ball out of the back of the end zone, and the extra points were landing on the balconies of apartment buildings behind him. It was slight hyperbole, but it was mostly true. He had a cannon for legs. He's just a very gifted athlete. Coach Oliver did tell me that he was, why can't I think out loud? But he's All-State. He was an All-State wide receiver. So that is not surprising to me. The athleticism that we saw really matched up with what he had going.
Not surprising to me at all. And so, but I got somebody in the studio. We got Baby D in the studio. And I want to get his perspective on being a young man in high school. Tell me what you see so far. Did you see the McKinley game? And what do you see?
Unfortunately, I did not see the McKinley game last night, but I seen the highlights on, it was WBRZ, the highlights, and McKinley got blew out. It seems like they could
put...
It's
not funny, man. I heard a little snicker. That's not funny.
But McKinley seems like they could put points on the board. It's just, like you said, the district is just so
there he is.
Good. It's just, the district just awesome. And they just can't compete with it so far right now.
Well, but, I think that McKinley is rebuilding. Of course, I think it's a principle, or it's a matter of a little bit of a discipline. Because we've seen a lot of times where McKinley is shooting themselves in the foot. Just give you a permanent example. The score was 13-0, and McKinley had came back and was able to drive the ball all the way down the field, get the ball inside the 5-yard line, come a fourth down, and they throw an interception.
In the end zone.
In the end zone. So that takes the team to the 20. Same amount of goals and scores. And now the score is 21-0 when it could have been probably 13-7. And so those little small dynamics starting out the game, McKinley was 1st and 10. They had made a good positive run, maybe 67 or 8 yards, but they were called for illegal procedure or a false start or whatever it was. And
pass interference.
Yeah, it's 2 times back-to-back. So they started out 1st and 20. You know, and when you're playing a team this good, you can't do that.
No.
You have to be more disciplined. Even on the 4th down, they came, the score was 7-0, and it was 4th down for St. Amar, 4th and 2.
Right.
McKinley not disciplined. Encroachment, get inside the neutral zone, and give them an automatic 1st down. And that very next play, St. Amant scores. And so those small things, I think, is what make a good team into a better team. And so those are the things you have to tighten those.
Yeah, and they're going to learn that. It's going to take some discipline at the quarterback position. Now we've seen Bryant Lee. I won't use the term baby steps. I'll just say regular steps. And he's kind of taking steps week to week. And we've seen where he's kind of. You know, he has a very strong arm, but kind of wildly overthrew people. He's doing that a little bit less. He forced balls a lot earlier in the year. He's doing that a little bit less, but he's got to do it even less than that for this team to get better. And whoever takes over at that position, because I believe he's a senior, whoever takes over at that position next year is going to have to demonstrate that type of discipline. And hey, lo and behold, who do we have on the line?
Who do we have on the line?
Dun, 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 dun.
Which coach is that?
That's Coach Perry Daniels, and I'm trying to.
Are you sure?
Trying to take his Skype call. I guess I can't even blame Windows 10 for this one. I think maybe I'm just technologically challenged today, Joker. But we're gonna get Coach Perry on the line any second now.
He's chomping at the bit, and I actually want to hear what he has to say. I know he listened to the game last night, and my whole thing is this. And, of course, I know St. Amant, these teams are very good. But my point is, am I seeing any improvement from game to game on McKinley's side? Whether or not they're winning the game or not, do I see improvement on the McKinley side? And to be honest with you, I'm not seeing as much improvement. I'm seeing a little consistency, but I'm not seeing much improvement. And what I mean by that is not necessarily too much on the defensive end, I just would like, and it's just me, I'm just a, armchair quarterback, basically. I'm not a coach. But I would like to see a little bit more diversity in the offense.
Right.
Running a few more.
They line up and shotgun every play.
Right, instead of lining up.
One back sets.
And you had them same about 5 plays that you're using. And so when these guys go in and watch film, they're already prepared for that. You just look like St. Amant was just prepared, you know, totally prepared for whatever McKinley was bringing to him. Now, when they came out in the second half and they started running the wide receiver, Josh Quiet, started running him on slant routes, something that you haven't seen McKinley do primarily this year, that started to work. Right. He started to let him use his physical gifts as big as he is. When you one-on-one on the inside on the slant pattern, it's pretty much hard to stop that. That's like Jimmy Graham.
He's
so big, once he get on that inside, it's going to be hard to stop. So I think they had a little success using that play last night. They was finally able to put some points on the board. Great defensive play that he straight took it from the quarterback. That was an amazing play on defensive end for McKinley.
Oh yeah, yeah. That was a little small. What do you call it? A silver lining in an otherwise dark cloud of a game for the McKinley Panthers. There was a play late in the game where they pretty much just literally ripped off the ball, and housed it.
Yeah.
So you know, I'll tell you what.
Just regular caller.
It's just stuck. I don't know what's going on. I am blaming Windows 10 now. It's just freezing up my screen here, so I'm sure Coach Perry can hear us. We're working on it. So anyway, no, we're going to go ahead and try to get Briggs on the line. So, Joker, just keep it rolling for a second. I think do we have Coach? I think we finally can grab Coach. Do we have Coach? Yeah. Go. Coach? No, we do not have Coach yet.
Not Coach.
It's still
not here.
It's still trying to call him.
I think he's still trying to call him. We're still trying to Skype Coach Perry Daniels in.
Just keep it.
Why do you do that? And why you freak out? See if you can get Coach on, man. Like I was saying, you know, I wish I could see a little bit more of diversity that's on the offensive end. It's not, you know, I'm not a coach. Just from my observation, it seems that we're saying the same.
Let's hope we have him this time. All right, I think we finally got him. Coach, are you there? All right.
Yeah.
All right. Good.
Jump right in, Coach. Tell us what you seen last night from McKinley and St. Amant. Can you hear me, Coach?
I can hear you. Yes, I can now.
Yeah.
Has Coach Sayer been on?
Not yet. I was saying, hey, go right in. Tell us what your observation was last night, McKinley and St. Amant.
Well, that's a really good St. Amant football team. And that class and that 5-5-A district is going to be extremely competitive between, the players there, St. Amant, Catholic High. It's just going to be extremely competitive. It's going to be interesting to see who comes out on top.
Right, and that's what I was saying. That's one thing I can say I was excited about. We've seen some really good teams, even though McKinley has came up on the losing end. But I've seen some really great teams. Scotlandville won pretty much 8 seconds left. Leon Lewis was able to, I think it was 15-yard pass with 8 seconds and no timeouts left. So that was a great game. And we also have seen St. Amant, General Springs, and basically we got Cali High to come, Dutchtown.
So keep in mind, Joker, Scotlandville and Denham Springs, they're in the other district, the other 5-5-A district that covers the Baton Rouge area. So McKinley and Scotlandville are in separate districts.
Right.
Oh, so no, I was going to say, we also, finally, it looks like our phone lines and lines of communication are opening up. We also have on the line the Louisiana All American Sports Player of the Week. Thank you for joining us this morning, calling in St. Amant Gators, Mr. Everything last night, Briggs Bourgeois, on the line, joining us this morning. Briggs, thank you for taking time out of the morning to join us. Talk a little bit for the audience that maybe didn't hear the post game last night. Talk about your game. We say that you have guys who do everything, and you really did it. Return punts, kicked off, caught passes, almost could have, would have, should have scored a 2-point conversion.
Man.
Talk about your game, young man.
Hey guys, remember to turn off the mic so I can.
Sure thing.
Yeah, I had a great game, but, you know, like I said, like my, you know, I can't do anything without all the rest of the players on the team. You know, we have a special group of seniors, so, you know, we all put in really hard work, so all those guys really helped me out last night.
You know, you mentioned that you guys kind of jumped on your opponent early. Talk about, I guess, the switch of momentum, what it was like on your sideline as you guys, let's say after the punt return, for example, which really seemed to be an early turning point in the game. Talk about the change in momentum, what the mood was on the sideline, what you all were talking about once after the punt return.
Yeah, well, our coach all week was talking to us that we're going to play over there and it was kind of a different environment for us. They were going to have kind of upper hand on the team, and you know, they're going to have a little fight. So I'm playing this whole kind of try to jump on top of them early.
Is it Christian McCaffrey?
And after the punt return, so we pretty much popped off. They're all pretty pumped up. So everything's switching on every phase of the game.
You guys are 6-0 at the moment. You have defeated most of your opponents, I think with the exception of one of the New Orleans teams by a very, very, very wide margin. Talk about the kind of confidence that gives you going ahead in the schedule down the line, and what your team's goals are for the season.
Well, yeah, we're 6-0, but last year we were 6-0. We picked that tough off the extension, which is our rival. But, you know, we're looking to, we're looking to next Friday, so we're looking to really get after them this year, especially after last year. But, you know, we have a lot of confidence. Each day we're getting better at practice. We're not taking any reps off, because we all know this is our last time, it's our last go around. So, everything right now, we have a lot of confidence.
We've seen a few teams that we've said quote unquote have championship potential, and your team looks like one of them. How far did you all advance last year in the postseason?
We lost to Honda.
Okay, and which round was that?
Second round.
Okay. Coach Perry Daniels is on the line. Coach, and also Joker, do you have what do you guys have for Briggs here?
Hey, first, congratulations on a big win last night. Who's next for the Santa Monica Gators? And let me hear who's next, and then I'll go.
We play EA. We have to at home.
The rivalry, the neighborhood war, the however you want to label it, the battle of ascension. I tell you what, based on what took place last year, I'm going to go ahead and give the Gators the edge here based on just motivation and the revenge factor. After next week, who do you see being the biggest obstacle left on the schedule?
They have this tough Catholic team that's on the schedule.
Yeah, what week is that Catholic game?
Wait, say that again?
Which week is Catholic High?
Week 8. So we play EA, then we follow up with Catholic. So we got two big games back to back.
Oh, wow. So you guys have... So you're getting into a really tough part of the schedule here. Great. So, again, I just want to say thank you for joining us this morning. Welcome to the Louisiana All American Sports Show. Congratulations on a good win last night. We wish you the best of luck on the rest of the season. Joker, did you have anything?
I just want to congratulate you. Actually, do you play any other sports? And is receiver, some wide receiver, you seem to be? You kind of remind me of Christian McCaffrey. I wanted to see what other players that you kind of idolize, and what's your favorite position to play?
Also, I do play soccer and baseball. But I do kick too, and I don't know if y'all knew, but I committed to Southern Miss to kick. So that's what I'm planning to do.
Congratulations, that's fantastic, man. And I did mention when we were watching the distance on those balls, I said he's going to be playing at somebody's college or university, and you might be doing more than kicking. So I'm not surprised. I have an affinity for place kickers. That's my own thing. Regular listeners of the show know that. So great job with all that.
So this is the second week in a row that we've had a kicker on. So you guys right. know who's picking the player.
Right. Hey, Eric. In all fairness, y'all know there was no dispute this go around.
That's what's up, man.
I'm joking. Let's ask about college recruiting since you went there, Eric.
Oh, well, look, yeah, so you're being recruited by university, so Southern Miss. Have you committed to Southern Miss? Is that kind of a done deal there?
Yes, sir.
That is a done deal, he said, Coach. What other schools tried to get you to be a part of their program before you committed to Southern Miss, and what made Southern Miss appealing to you?
I had offers from Nichols and... In Texas Southern.
Mm-hmm.
I've been like 3 or 4 times, so, and this is a really nice place. It kind of feels like home.
I can appreciate it feeling like home, and of course it's not that far from Baton Rouge. You're talking about Hattiesburg. That's probably about a good 2.5-hour drive, so you're far away enough from home to experience all the fun and independence of college, and still close enough to get back whenever you need to, which is awesome. So, look, guys, Briggs, we're picking up a little bit of background noise there, so we're gonna, I guess, let Briggs run in just a minute.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
Sounds like home, though.
All right, well, look, Briggs, thank you so much for joining us. What I'll do is eventually I'm going to upload this to YouTube, and I'll send you the link so that all your friends, in Santa Monica and your teammates can listen. And, look, great job. And really, if your teammates are listening, Briggs is such a team player, because when I spoke to him last night, he finished and ended with talking about how the excellence of his performance was not possible without his team.
Give him applause before we leave.
And absolutely.
We're going to give you an applause before we leave. Louisiana All American Sports Show, you are our player of the game, man. Awesome job last night.
Briggs Bourgeois, Louisiana All American Sports player of the week.
Player of the week, man. It sounds like home, too. You hear the background.
Yeah, man. Oh, yeah. He's probably cutting up.
It reminds me of home. Yeah. You got the kids going. Good. I look like just that father back there.
Good luck, young man. Thank you so much for joining us.
Cooking hamburgers.
Appreciate it.
Peace, man.
So that was Briggs, Bourgeois, player of the week. It's got to be coach's background, not.
Okay.
So look, that was fantastic.
Must be coach cooking chicken in the background.
Must be.
So guys, before we move on to our musical break, Eric, are you off of your regular job Monday?
No, sir. You're not the first person to ask me that, but I don't think we're getting Columbus Day this year. I think it's because we're getting Election Day. I don't know. But no, I'm not off on Monday.
Okay. Well, I wanted to use that to segue in. I'm wondering when we as a society are going to remove that holiday from our calendar. It is racist in its nature. It is supremacist in its nature. And I'm wondering why in 2016 we're still celebrating a lie.
Great point, Coach. Great point. And that'll take us right into our musical selection, which is from none other than K. Reno, Not the Only One. I want you guys to check this out.
Yep.
Because Perry just said a lot.
Hey, good pick.
And you're not the only one, you know what I mean? So that was K. Reno. Perry just said something. Coach Perry had to go, audience, but he said something that was real profound. I thought he talked about Columbus Day and the impact that it has, and how, a lot of us are oblivious to what it actually means. But so, hey, we're gonna get into that more a little bit at another time. But we definitely gonna discuss that. Right now, we're gonna have to get into a little bit of college sports here.
Absolutely,
and of course, and the HBCU. These guys have actually been doing pretty good. I've been watching how a lot of the teams, of course, Southern. I don't understand how they get two bye weeks back to back, but you know.
The only thing I can imagine, Joker, is maybe one was their actual bye week, probably the week before Jackson State, and maybe the other was a Division II opponent or a smaller opponent that had to bail for some reason.
Right. Well, you know.
Oh yeah, and actually, Baby D is telling us there was a droppage on the schedule from the Southern University schedule. It was a smaller school, so that makes sense because otherwise two bye weeks is very strange.
Well, LSU is getting another bye week, pretty much.
yeah, unwittingly.
But you know, they had one last year where we had with the Lightning and everything in the stadium.
Right,
it was another game they didn't make up and actually takes away, numbers basically from Fournette because I think he probably could have eclipsed 2,000 if you would have had that extra.
Absolutely. And because he's averaging well over 100 yards a game. And the other thing, too, is that it's an SEC game. I'm very surprised that an organization as large and as powerful as the SEC didn't have a contingency plan. It's not like you're in the southeastern United States.
Right.
Storms come every year.
Right.
You don't have been. South Carolina had the flooding last year. They moved the game to Baton Rouge. I don't know what politics went on there, but I think that's egg on their face.
Yeah.
That's bad. There's no reason that this game. I'm not necessarily saying play it today. I'm just saying it should be played. There should be a date, and they should be ready to go.
They should be ready to go, man. People spend too much money. Both of these teams are prestigious schools. Damn, got tongue twisted. But I think there's no excuse for these guys not to be able to come together and play this game. Could have brought it right here to Baton Rouge.
Absolutely.
I mean, a lot of fans, man. You're talking about a lot of disappointed people on both sides.
Exactly.
Florida and LSU.
Well, see, it is going to work from an athletic standpoint. It could work to Florida's favor because Florida lost to Tennessee. So now a 6-2 Florida and 6-2 Tennessee team, the tiebreaker will go to Tennessee. 6-1 Florida, that's a higher winning percentage. And they basically don't suffer. They have six wins. They don't suffer the loss like they did for losing to Tennessee. So there's some skullduggery there, and that's why I rolled it up to the Southeastern Conference and put this on them. They should have managed this better. They should have had a better plan. The notion of this game not being played is unacceptable. I hope they find some way to get it done, to ram it in there somewhere.
Well, hey, well, on the other side of town, we're talking about HBCUs in the top 10. I wanted to share with you guys the top 10 of the HBCUs this year. Southern is in the top 10, so I will tell you that. Grambling is in the top 10. But the number one team is North Carolina A&T. These guys, 2016 record is, 3-1. And so they're at the top spot. Coming in at number two, Tennessee State. Tennessee State is actually 4-0 and a very good team. And they're coming in at number two. Number three is Grambling. Grambling is 3-1. And we know Grambling had a history of being good this year. Of course, we are expecting them to be in the top five, and they are.
They're meeting high expectations so far.
Most definitely. Coming in at number four is Tuskegee. They're 5-0, actually. So they have the best record here of the top 10, and they're coming in at number four. Number five is North Carolina Central. They're 3-2. Number six is Prairie View A&M. They're also 3-2. And coming in at number seven is the Southern Jaguars. Southern is in the top 10. They're at number seven. They're with a 2-2 record. Number eight is South Carolina State. Number nine is Alcorn State. Number 10 is Bowie State. And so Southern is still in the top 10. We'll see. Their record to me reflects the way the season's been going. It can go either one way or the other, but I'm expecting good things from Southern from what I've seen so far. Coach Odoms.
The Jags are looking.
I'm not going to play with his emotions.
Oh, no, I would not play with any man's emotions. I would definitely not play with Coach Big Worm because I'm going to tell you something. Coach Odom just called the hotline. Coach, thanks for joining us this morning. What you got for us today?
What's going on, Coach? How you doing?
Whoa. Okay, that was the wrong one. That was Smokey.
That was the other guy. I think that was the assistant coach.
Yeah, that was the wide receivers coach. You know, those guys are a little smaller, have higher pitched voices.
Coach Odom, man. Coach Odom. I wouldn't play with that guy. But he's doing a fabulous job. since he's been there, and so I know he has a lot to say.
Yeah, he does, and we're going to get Coach. We're going to try to get him back on the hotline real quick. But let's go ahead and go ahead and move out to this current topic. So the Southern University Jaguars, they are well rested. They are on 2 weeks of rest.
2 weeks vacation.
They're undefeated in the SWAC. They are 2-0. As I mentioned, they did play two FBS schools, both Tulane and ULM. And while they lost pretty handily, they showed they were competitive at times in different phases of the game, and that wasn't necessarily always the case when they play those higher conference opponents. So, you know, I have a lot of optimism about the Southern University Jaguars team, and the big one, the big rivalry game against Jackson State. They're going to Jackson next week, to Mississippi, and this is really where the rubber is going to hit the road, so to speak. Now, of course, Southern missing those two games, I wonder if one of them was a home game, and the Southern University team did not take in, the Southern University Athletic Department did not take in the money they normally used to take in from that home game they missed. Right. And then we finally got Coach Odoms on the line. Coach, could you just very briefly talk about the potential financial impact of not having that game on the schedule?
Yeah, tell us about it, Coach.
Playing with my money is like playing with my emotions.
I don't want to play with that man's emotions.
Oh, man, I can't play with Coach Odoms' emotions. Hey, I thank you for getting straight to the point. We tried to ask him a real complex question, but yeah, he went straight to it.
See, this is why this guy's in a coaching position. They can give succinct answers. They can take complex concepts and boil it down very, very quickly.
Hey, he just let you know, playing with my money.
It's like playing with my emotions. Hey, Coach, I hear you. And he is not letting anyone play with his money. And actually, the Southern University system is taking very good care of Coach Odoms, because he's doing a fantastic job. Look, the Jackson State University game coming up next week, we'll talk about it in greater detail. But Jackson State's on a similar, they're 2-1 in SWAC. Their only loss is to Grambling. Grambling's a team, just to put it in perspective, they're playing so well in SWAC. This is a team that went to Arizona, which is a Pac-12 school, and they were leading 21-3 at halftime. So this is a really, really good Grambling team with a lot of good athletes, such as Chad Williams, who Coach Perry and I had the chance to coach at Madison Prep Academy right here in Baton Rouge. This is a good team. You know, they did lose to Grambling. Of course, their out-of-conference game, their major conference game was against UNLV, and that was pretty one-sided, but they defeated Pine Bluff very soundly. They got into a slugfest with Mississippi Valley State, and I just don't think Mississippi Valley State has improved that much to where if you're a serious contender in the SWAC, you should be slugging it out with a team like that. So at the moment, I'm going to reserve my right to change this one because the game is a week from today, but right now I think they are very capable of going to Jackson and taking that win on the road. If they do, they're going to be sitting very pretty in the Western Division.
Sitting very pretty, you know. Halle Berry. Yeah. Halle Berry.
Halle Berry. So
I think also, I totally agree with you, Eric. I think after 2 weeks of basically vacation, you should be prepared. The next game, you should have a lot of film study. You should, you know, have a lot of good practices. You should be able to heal up from any type of nagging injuries.
That's a big one.
Exactly, and that's a big one. So I give the advantage to Southern. Right now, I'm going to pick Southern.
Yep, I'm tentatively picking Southern. I do reserve the right to change my mind. I don't gamble, but if I did gamble, I'd put it on Southern. The reason I don't gamble is
playing with my money is like playing with my emotions.
Yep, I'm on the same page with Coach on that one.
Yeah, and I'm back that. I'm 100% behind that.
So we're going to hop in that 1983 Cadillac Seville with the bumper falling off.
Let's go to the other side.
On the other side of town, moving quickly, running swiftly in the hoopty ride.
You know, 8-Ball looks a little bit like Coach Perm, like Big Worm, too. He could play Big Worm if they did did like an alternative version of Friday.
Probably his cousin.
They might be kin.
Oh, yeah.
But you know, LSU, interesting. So let's talk about the whole sequence of events with the Tigers. We have a good
Have you recovered yet? Have you recovered from the Les Miles fire? I know that hurt you. I know you went through withdrawal. You went through, you know.
The management, you know, like Coach Miles, I made no secret about that. My problem, I was prepared mentally.
Were you surprised?
Yes, I was. I was mentally prepared for him to be fired last year. I was at peace with it. I understand how it works. I was prepared for him to get fired this year if they didn't at least win the West.
Right.
I get it. I've been watching college football for years. Fine. To fire a guy in September after one conference loss, which I think really jeopardizes the season long term. I mean, they played well last week. We'll see how that continues. I'm really concerned about that, and I thought it was Joe Oliva trying to cover his backside. I really did.
Now, how do you feel now after winning one game? After seeing LSU, how do you feel now?
I mean, I expected them to beat Missouri in the first place. I didn't. The throttling they gave them, the near shutout, I'll say that was a pleasant surprise. And maybe Coach O did maybe take some of the
restraints.
Right, some of the cuffs off of the offense a little bit. I thought Danley Etling played well. He made those plays that we kind of talked about this a couple of weeks ago. He made the throws you would expect a college quarterback to make. I thought Darius Geis ran exceptionally well in relief of Leonard Fournette. It does even their record in the Southeastern Conference, but at the end of the day, Joker, it's just Missouri. A real test would have come today in the Swamp.
Yes.
Unfortunately, and our prayers are with everybody on that Florida Central Coast area with Hurricane Matthew. It's a monster storm, and because of the storm, the game, which would have started at 11 o'clock this morning, is either the SEC has said it wants to reschedule the game, but as of right now, the game is not played today. It is postponed or possibly canceled because there's no rescheduled date as of now.
Actually, it's a game, but they're playing games.
They're playing games. They're winning. Right. They are up. Florida is up on LSU right now. They are playing the Southeastern Conference and Louisiana State University and Joe Oliva for some chumps right now. But look, let's talk about some of the differences that we saw last week. I thought the offense, I thought there was more diversity of the play calling. It wasn't as run heavy. It was still a running offense, but it wasn't so predictably run heavy with Cam Cameron. I thought they used a greater diversity of formations. I thought they got receivers. They took the high percentage passing routes that were available. I didn't always see that. Sometimes they just run the ball and give it to Fournette or Geis because of their big play ability or Williams. And so I like the diversity I saw. Obviously, they scored a lot of points. I don't know how much of a measuring stick Missouri is yet. The defense continued, played very well. Missouri has definitely shown they're capable of putting up a lot of points. I think they had the highest scoring offense in the SEC, one of the top five in the country, I think, and they were almost shut out. So, I kind of expected them to beat Missouri, so I don't know how much that tells us. So,
well,
I guess,
I mean, I actually expect them to beat Auburn.
Well, you know what? But for a deal with the clock, I thought they would have beaten Auburn too.
Well,
but I guess it's the replay
Auburn,
round.
But,
right.
You know, for a team to not score a touchdown and beat you guys score, what, six field goals?
Correct.
It shouldn't have came down to that type of play to me against a team like Auburn.
Yeah.
I think with what Coach O is doing so far, I think a lot of it has to do with motivation. I think the team was just up to play to show that we're past Les Miles or Forrest. Because it could have went either two ways. They could have been salty about Les Miles and not played as up to their potential. Or they could have said, hey, you know, we're going to show that we're still a team. This is not going to split us up. And I think they came out with that. And Coach O did that at another school.
Did that at USC after they fired Steve Sarkisian. And he went 6-2 down the stretch, which was better than they had played at any point under Sarkisian. I mentioned this last week, Joker, that when Joe Oliva fired Les Miles, you don't get any credit for setting a building on fire and then not having the fire department on speed dial. But when Oliva made that move, which I think really burned down this whole season, he made a smart play in having Ed Orgeron in his back pocket. Ed Orgeron is a great motivator of players. He's a fantastic recruiter. That's why Les Miles hired him in the first place. Everywhere he goes, his players loved him, both in college and the NFL. You know, the only hair on his record is when he was head coach at Ole Miss. It did not go well. There's just no way to sugarcoat that. But still, this man he might be in the Hall of Fame of assistant coaches. And I guess my question to you, Joker, two things. What differences did you notice last week in LSU, Missouri, that might have been coaching related? And also, do you think they're going to keep Ed Orgeron, and what do you think it might take to keep him?
Yeah, you know, we talked about this actually with you and Mission Control, Derek. I know he's probably listening. He even suggested to give Orgeron a two-year contract. Do you remember that?
I do remember that.
And I said, well, let's see how he does the rest of the season. He's a great coach. He kind of reminds me of Les Miles. And the fact that his players play for him, and he's a likable guy, he's like seems like to be you know, players would run through a brick wall for
precisely
him, and recruiting, and so that's big to me. What I saw with LSU is the same thing that you saw. You saw a different offense. You saw a more freer type offense, not as predictable. And from what I'm saying, from what I'm hearing, they're saying the coach said, "Hey, we're gonna bring the offense up to the 2000, mm-hmm. you know, up to mm-hmm. 2000. We're gonna get to 2015 down the line, you know, and even further."
He's a character.
Just joking, but he even knew, and I think the writing had been on the wall. I think Joe Oliva, when Coach O came there, he already had that plan in his head. As soon as it's going to be a quick hook on Les Miles. And for to lose that game, Auburn, even before that, well, to lose to Wisconsin right out the gate, that put them first.
Now, how bad is that loss to Wisconsin in hindsight?
You're talking about they destroyed. Wisconsin is a good team.
Top 10 team.
Yeah, Wisconsin. But it's still LSU. LSU was supposed to be a top five team.
They were. Coming back.
They have all of the players, that, you know, the defense. the quarterback came, and of course, he had, you know, that was just so disappointing to me with him, with not being able to be there that long, Harris,
right,
and not be able to progress. You know, I don't know if that's coaching, I don't know if that's, or is it him?
And at a certain point, and he's his third year with the program now, at a certain point, you got to plug in the guy who's going to help you win. I don't know what, like I said, I had high expectations for him.
He was too.
An Under Armour All-American, heck of an arm, a very strong arm. It just seemed like he didn't. Here's my problem, though, and you can only coach this up so much. It seemed like the throws you'd expect an SEC quarterback to make, he was having trouble making. Seven, 8 yard out routes, and that's ultimately, it's got to be, after 3 years, it's on the quarterback, it's not the coach.
Fold under the pressure, mm-hmm. and not be able to, you know, like to say, hey, pressure can you know, it can crush, or it also can make a diamond, either way, you know.
I like that analogy.
It's just about how you handle the pressure, and I just thought Brandon Harris never got to that next step. And this guy comes right in and, you know, hey, he's doing what he has to do. He's maybe not the best quarterback, but they're winning.
So, right. He's doing what
he has confidence, and you can see it.
And he's making those throws you expect him to make. It's the opposite of what we talked about a moment ago with Brandon Harris.
And it'll make Fournette better, because now you're starting to bring the whole offense in, like you said, with the being able to get the open plays, the little bubble screens, getting the receivers. And now you got these guys feeling like they're a part of the winning, of the team.
Absolutely.
And so when you're incorporating the wide receivers and they're getting more touches, you know, instead of just throwing the ball to Leonard Fournette, and you know, the Dupree's and them, and give these guys a chance to make plays, and it opens it up for Fournette at the end of the day. You know, it's like Michael Jordan at first. Like, once Michael mm-hmm. Jordan learned that he don't have to shoot every time, he started making the extra pass.
And he got Pippen.
And the ball, right, and he got Pippen, but the ball ended up coming back to you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, give it out a little bit, then you know, get it back.
And it frees you up more.
Yeah, and it frees you up more, so.
We did have a comment. We have another hotline call.
Yeah,
Coach Miles. Coach, I did want to know, just when you were fired, it was a bit of a surprise to me. What was your response when you learned of the news?
Coach,
goodness.
It's going to be all right, Coach.
Yeah, it's he's going to land on his feet.
Yeah, he's going to land on his feet somewhere. You'll get a job. Talking about this young coach out of Houston. What do you
Coach Herman, I like. Look, I hope we can get him. When I was in high school, I hoped I can get the homecoming queen.
Did you get it?
No, I wasn't. LSU is definitely on the homecoming court, if you will. I was not. And so so I didn't get her. But I'll tell you, but Herman is the equivalent. That coach is the equivalent of the homecoming queen. And LSU is that kind of a program. But there's going to be a lot of competition for Tom Herman. He is a spectacular offensive genius. He has the University of Houston looking like an SEC school, the way they're playing.
Yes.
Just dismantling folks. So. Yeah, I hope so. I will hope him, and I will see. That is definitely my first choice. If I could just pick anybody based on what I know today.
We'll see how it goes.
You know, also in college football right now, we do have the Red River rivalry, Texas and Oklahoma right now. I promise you we're going to make it. The game did start already, but I'm not looking at the screen. I'm not looking at the score. I am picking Oklahoma, 20th ranked Oklahoma. First of all, they're in Norman, Oklahoma. Oklahoma.
Well, they're actually in Dallas.
They're in Dallas.
Yeah.
Okay.
Know, every year that.
Oh,
that game,
you're right. My bad. I'm tripping there. Is it the Cotton Bowl? Yes. Okay. Yeah. Thank you, Joker. Thank you for setting me straight. I still like Oklahoma in this game, though. Oklahoma has been a little shaky, and they've had some some head scratching. They had some head scratching games this year, but Texas just seems to be in a state of distress right now.
Well, I think Charlie Strong's job is on the line, so I think Texas is going to respond. These are the type of games. Actually, he won last year. If I want to,
I think he did.
Yeah, he won last year, even though Texas had a bad record last year. He has a freshman quarterback. Charlie Strong does, but I'm going to go with Texas in this game. I'm going to go with Texas in this game to basically upset Oklahoma. I think Oklahoma is number 20th.
They are.
Yeah, ranked number 20. So
they are a team that can be upset. So. I mean, it is, and you can sometimes throw the record out of the window with rivalries.
Exactly.
And this Oklahoma is an upsettable team, if that's a word.
Yes.
You know, they are a very upsettable
Bob
team.
Stoops is looking very shaky. I've been hearing rumors about him, his job security, too. As long as he's been down in Oklahoma, but he's a guy that couldn't quite. Well, he won the big game. I want to say once, but other than that, he took a shellacking in bowl games.
I mean, Coach, with the bowl, Coach Stoops with the bowl game performances, and now these rumors after so many years in Oklahoma, how does that make you feel?
It's
one of those days.
It's gonna be all right, man.
So look, we have we talked about a little bit of football. We're in Louisiana. Coming up. Well, look, coming up about 5 minutes, we have Noel Jackson with Music Satisfaction right here on 96.9 FM WHYRLP Baton Rouge Community Radio. Louisiana has kind of, I guess, an intermission from football. I almost don't know what to do with myself right now.
Tom Brady coming back.
Yeah, man, as I was going to talk about, we're going to go from the boys and talk about the men of the National Football League. So, the Saints last week finally got that first win of the season against the San Diego Chargers.
It was like Christmas, that was like a gift.
It was like passing a kidney stone, man.
Yeah.
It was like passing a kidney stone, but they finally San Diego shot themselves in the foot worse than the Saints did, and the Saints were able to steal one 35-34 on the road. They're off this week. We do have one game that we wanted to talk about as far as picking for the I Told You So, and that's coming up in just a minute. The Atlanta Falcons are a surprising 3-1 team. I did not think they had it in them. I don't care who their opponents were. They are putting up just piles of offense. They destroyed the Carolina Panthers, the defending NFC champions. They're going out to the Mile High City to face the Broncos. I do think they meet their Waterloo here, because in spite of having a rookie quarterback, Trevor Siemian, he's looking like a veteran. And with that defense and the running game and C.J. Anderson, and they're at home, I think Denver continues to go undefeated after this week.
Julio.
Ooh.
Don Julio. I'm down with Julio, man, so I'm going with the Atlanta Falcons to upset the Denver Broncos this week. That's Joker P's upset game of the week. I got the Atlanta Falcons going into Denver in the Mile High Stadium and upsetting the Denver Broncos. Yeah.
Well, we'll see. We'll see if that upset comes through.
Let's
real quick though. We did. Of course, we put our pride and our mouths up to the mic, and our pride spewed out of it. And actually, there was only one person wearing his egg on his face, and it's the guy talking into the mic right now. As we always do around this time, it's I Told You So.
I told you. What did I tell you? Didn't I tell you? 'Cause I told you. Mm-hmm. And when did I tell you? A long time ago. And what did I say will happen when I told you? Exactly what just happened.
Drew Brees, for the first time in his career, is going back to San Diego to face the San Diego Superchargers. Nothing super about him at all. It's definitely some... I think San Diego's got problems, but I think because they're at home and the Saints are traveling out west, I think they're going to be 0-4 when they come back.
It's homecoming for Drew Brees. I think he's going to throw for 400 yards.
Do you think he'll get the W?
Yes.
Any comments there?
I think that since they are on a losing streak, I think that they know that they need to work hard, that they need to do what they need to get a win. So.
I'm gonna go with the Saints here as well, because I just think that they can rally together. They're out of the city where they can focus, and they've traditionally been a halfway decent team recently.
I told told you. What did I tell you? Didn't I tell you? Because I told you. Mm-hmm. And when did I tell you? A long time ago. And what did I say will happen when I told you? Exactly what just happened.
Drew Brees, for the first time in his career, is going back to San Diego to face the San Diego Superchargers. Nothing super about him at all. It's definitely some... I think San Diego's got problems, but I think because they're at home and the Saints are traveling out west, I think they're going to be 0-4 when they come back.
That was out of order. So I put the sound effects out of order.
He's going to throw for 400 yards.
Do you think he'll get the W?
Yes.
Any comments there?
I think that since they are on a losing streak, I think that they're going to, they know that they need to work hard, that they need to do what they need to get a win, so...
That was the kicker for Century.
I'm going to go with the Saints here
as well. I just think that they can rally together. They're out of the city where they can focus, and they've traditionally been a halfway decent team recently.
So I'll tell you what, I inadvertently gave myself more credit than I deserved. That should have been a buzzer. I picked the Chargers. I put the buzzer in between my comments by mistake. That's what happens when you're up with twins all night and you start trying to edit sound first thing in the morning. Look, we really quick, we got about another maybe minute and a half. No, not even a minute left. Look, we know there were shootings in El Cajon, California, outside of San Diego, Los Angeles, and D.C.
Lingo, 30-year-old.
Another, I don't have any. Well, at least we don't have enough time to give you an update, but we will update you as these develop.
We're definitely going to update on you. You could look at this story. It's all over the internet. It was Al Cajon, 30-year-old Alfred Alingo. I also wanted to send my my thoughts out to the people that lost their lives in Haiti. It was over 800 people from Hurricane Matthew, and the people that's in Florida, the people that's just want to say that you all are in my thoughts in Florida and up the East Coast. To the people that's being affected by Hurricane Matthew, Louisiana All American Sports stands with you.
Absolutely, I tell you, the acute poverty in Haiti is just devastating to see how a storm like this, which is awful, with the poverty they have there compounding, it makes the loss of life so much worse than here in the United States. It's bad here in the United States, but there it's just heartbreaking. So look, if Perry's folks are still listening to the show, he want me to say ADTJNS, he loves you. My wife and kids, Angela, Erica, Elizabeth, Daddy loves you, and have a good afternoon.
Peace.
Protect us from the evil. Hail to the King, Lord of Life.